It's been a big year. I mean, you guys are talking about the Nobel Prize, you're talking about multi-messenger, you're talking about major lifetime accomplishments for yourselves and for the scope. And now we're looking at the future. So what comes next for LIGO? What do you see happening next?
Well, I'll give you the near term.
Yeah.
In the near term, there's that we have to get to design sensitivity for the apparatus that's now been installed. That isn't the best thing we can make. It's just that that apparatus that is in there now is not working at exactly where we expect it to.
So the potential for the instrument that's already there is
there's
more potential.
There's somewhere around a factor of two, let's say, maybe, which is big. As you know, when you start talking about distance and you talk about the rate of events, that's factor of 10 almost in events. That's a big factor. I mean, now we're seeing an event every month, maybe every couple of months. So, you know, you're 8 weeks, you have an event a week, maybe a little less than that. Now, that doesn't get us all what we want. I mean, we're going to have more events, but there's parts of the events, for example, just let's take the black hole events by themselves. We'd love to see, for example, what happens at the very end of that collision. Right now, the data, if you look carefully at the data, if you for a single event, you can't tell very much about a wonderful new thing that happens when the black holes finally merge and they make a new black hole. The geometry around that, though, the geometry itself has normal modes of its own. It sings, it rings like a bell. We never see that. It's been calculated for years. And you would love to see, do those normal modes exist? Do they have the right frequencies? And the other thing we'd love to know more about this system is, for example, we'd love to know more about the spins, the individual spins. Just take the thing we already know. And even for those, it would be nice to have some improvement even above where we are now, or where we will be when we make that factor of two improvement. And people are thinking of sort of closer term improvements that each will have a scientific goal of sorts. For example, if we get another factor of two above that, you might get a chance to see the ring down, okay?
The ring down after the collision.
Yeah, after the collision, yeah. I mean, it depends on, well, a close one you could see very easily.
Yeah,
if you can see several normal modes of vibration, you can really test, is this black hole really the type that is described by the mathematics of general relativity, a so-called Kerr black hole? If the frequencies and the ring down rates are not quite right, then something is fundamentally different.
So you've been calculating and you've been exploring all of the ideas of what could be.
Well, my colleagues have been.
Or your colleagues have been, and you've been helping with theory. But what have you been hoping to see? So when we get to this next level of instrumentation.
Be careful that you get the thing right. I'm talking about small increments.
Okay.
There are other things to talk about.
Right.
Yeah. I mean,
right.
These are things near term, let's say within the next 5 years.
So okay. Say within the next 30 years.
That's something else.
What are
that's
some
a
things
very different thing.
So within the next 30 years. With a new instrument, starting over again, a huge, huge improvement, going, seeing out, say, 10 or 30 times farther than LIGO, than the current instruments at design sensitivity, maybe 100 times farther than the current instruments today.
So you're getting a whole
and
bunch of...
100 times farther means the volume of the universe, a million times bigger.
That's huge.
A million times bigger. It means seeing black hole mergers, every one that occurs in the universe out to what we call a redshift of 15. And we think almost all of them are younger than that. That there were perhaps none or hardly any ever formed earlier than that. Seeing basically everything.
So when you get that scope at that scale of seeing all of these collisions in all of this space, what sorts of events might you expect to find that we just can't see now, things that are at that earlier stage?
You'll have extremely strong signals that will enable you to test the dynamics of curved space-time when it's oscillating wildly. The shape of space is oscillating wildly. The rate of flow of time is oscillating wildly. Sort of the most extreme thing short of quantum gravity, the most extreme thing that can occur in terms of space and time in the universe, to study it with exquisite precision.
So
to me, that's the most exciting thing. But beyond that, to do a census of all the black holes in the universe or the colliding black holes in the universe below about a few hundred solar masses. And I mean, it's and do a census with very high precision, and then thereby to work out observationally the history of black hole formation and evolution in the universe. When did they first form? Were there black holes that formed in the very, very first population of stars? Do some of them precede the first population of stars? Do most of them form through hierarchical mergers inside globular clusters? You form little black holes, they collide, make bigger black holes, they collide, make bigger black holes. What is the history? How does this happen?
So at that scale, you're talking about fundamental processes that we can't explore in other ways yet. Okay, that's great. And then Barry, how are we going to make this happen?
First, we got to know how to make it happen technically.
Right.
I think that's the real challenge now. And that's hard work. It takes a long time to develop the technologies, and you have to start early.
And this is fundamental engineering in the sense that we don't even know how to do it yet.
Well, first we have to pick what are the priorities. You can make all the plans, but they may take very different kinds of instruments or optimization of the instruments. So what we have to do is understand what kind of instruments conceptually we can make, and we're just starting to do that. They've done more in Europe than we have. And then we have to ask what it means in terms of developing the technologies and cost, things
right,
like that.
Right.
So the technologies that we talk about, for example, are cooling the whole thing to reduce the thermal effects. And that's hard. The materials you use change. When you cool, it introduces shaking, and so it's a difficult problem.
So when you change one part of the system, you've then got to accommodate, and you're the engineer too, so if you change one part of the system, you've got to accommodate for the changes that are going to happen elsewhere.
Well, there are a lot of different things. I mean, there's a whole set of things that we already now know we would like to be able to do. Let me put it this way. On paper, we can see what Kip was saying. If cooling, using quantum-tailored light, using new kinds of test masses, new kinds of coatings, a whole bunch of steps have to be taken.
Conceptually.
But it's all conceptual at this moment. But if you can achieve it, there's no fundamental reason we shouldn't be able to do this.
Each of the conceptual ideas appear to be doable in this time scale, but the difference between that and really pulling it off is enormous.
Yeah, well,
even I, as a theorist, know that.
Yeah. I mean, that's the difference between why, when in the beginning of LIGO, we could have already anticipated a lot of stuff. We did, in fact. But then to make it actually happen and build the things and not get into trouble with something you forgot about or something which was more difficult to build than you thought or a noise that you hadn't ever even anticipated. Now, that's sort of that kind of thing that happens. And that takes the time. But you have to have the ability to do that. You have to have some funds to do that, and you have to have places to do that and to try it out. So these are things which we can lay out now a program of how you might get a factor of 100. But now you have to go and say, okay, let's start working on them one after the other.
But then you've already gotten to this milestone here. And what is that like to kind of arrive at a point where, you know, there were all the sleepless nights and all the unknowns, and you had decades of that?
The ideas sort of for all of this sort of started at a level when our technology was good to strains of 10 to the minus 14. Maybe. Okay, so now we are at strains of 10 to the minus 21.
And we knew that's where we had to go.
And we knew we had to go there because Kip,
that's where the,
because Kip
that's
told
where,
us we well, had to be there.
No, okay. the community I come from, we're targeting 10 to the minus 21 as early as 1978.
Yeah. Wow, okay, so you knew, and that was unimaginable at the time,
Well, of
right?
course, yeah, yeah. But we could see how to do it, maybe. And now the point is it gets harder and harder. And with the thing that we're talking about now, we're already at a point where if you now want another factor of 10, for example, or even let's say 100, you can see 10 is let's start there. You already have steps which are in some regards a little more difficult than the ones you took earlier. For example, one of the things that are being tested now is we're trying to use quantum tailored light. That's been done by people in Europe.
And what is quantum tailored light?
It's called squeezed light. It's light that does not have the same probability distribution for making noise. The ordinary light we've been using out of a laser, it's tailoring the light, okay? So it has less noise in certain frequency bands. And that's an elegant technique, and we're pushing that very hard, but that's gonna get us. We have to learn how to use more intensity, that's another thing. We have to learn how to make the coatings so that they themselves not making thermal noise as much as it is now. cooling everything is one way to go. It may not be the only way to do it. You may, in fact, want to use crystalline coatings if you want a specific. So there's all these branch points that people.
But looking back to where we came from, the key step was turning this thing into a real project with a real leader, which is Barry, who could develop a program to pull this off step by step by step by step by step. And that's a big part. It's the R&D, but it's also developing a very wisely defined program that Barry is the world expert at.
You know, and that's an interesting point, and that's not the sexy part. You know,
it's be careful.
You're getting everybody organized. Yeah, and yet,
it's pretty damn interesting.
But that's what I'm getting at, is and yet that's so critical for projects large and small, is you can envision whatever you want, but if you can't execute it, then it's just still on the drawing board. So dive into that a little bit. I mean, how do you get from a wrangling thousands of people, or at least hundreds of people, and all of this crazy engineering and concept into something that actually happened?
Well, I think if you have a clear goal, it's easier. Right now, what we're talking about is harder, which is that we want to develop the techniques that can move us to the next step. And you're not sure which ones will pan out. And there's not an easy kind of programmatic way to make them hierarchical before you do it, like you do when you do something in your life, you pick priorities. It's hard to do that at this stage. We know the different areas that can get us this factor of 100, and you have to make some choices and try to pursue them. And that's why it's hard, important to start as early as possible, so that when we start doing a project, which becomes very difficult, we have all the tools, we have the concepts, and we know. So we have the ideas now, or the concepts, but we don't know which ones are problematic, which ones can be realized. They interact with each other. If you cool it, because that's quieter, then you have to use different materials. We don't know which materials and so forth. So
right. And then you have to be flexible when things don't go the way you expect.
Yeah. Well, you have parallel developments. I mean, if you're trying to do that, if you can, So in a sense, we know more about what we can gain scientifically. What we need is an aggressive program to develop the techniques. Right. We've done the easy stuff.
Right. Well, what do you think, at this point? At this point, you've also reached a certain level in terms of the science, in terms of matching the theory to the observations and then getting to a level of understanding what's happening and getting excited about what's being seen. This may be something you may not want to answer, but is there a way to, if you could really arm wave, to anticipate some of the things that you may not expect?
It's a good question, because we try to look for the unexpected. We have a whole group that looks at that, and we have algorithms, but it's almost impossible to do that without some biases. So we use a certain mathematical technique called wavelets to develop a way that doesn't have a physical origin to look for it. And in fact, it was that method that saw the first event, rather than the method where we were looking exactly for what we found. But that's got biases in it. So how to look at our data for the unexpected is a big challenge. I actually think some new techniques might be helpful. For example, deep learning, where in a sense we can look at the data and look for things that don't look like the patterns that we see with lots and lots of data normally.
Is that a big data problem that we're all happy about here? Because that's one of our major
Well, the question is, when you look for something, you don't know what you're looking for, because that's exactly how we want to do it. You have to have ways to do it that don't have the biases built in, that almost have to be built in for us to look at data. Yeah. So,
but let me give you, since Kip isn't speaking up, I'm gonna do it for him. Okay. And that is, he's made this analogy over and over. I'll do it for him, and he'll probably say, I didn't do it right, but let me try. And that is that if you look at what we're doing with this field, we're now looking at something really quite different than other astronomies have done. In other words, the source of gravitational waves are accelerating mass, okay? What almost all of our knowledge of the universe is based on is accelerating charge. That's electromagnetic. So I'll give you a good example in a minute, one example that I know where that is going to make a profound difference. But the fact is that if you just look at the story of even the one where we understood more, namely charges accelerating, each time we looked with a different instrument in terms of a different wavelength, or a different set of conditions at the source, which then radiated at a different wavelength. You learned new stuff.
Right.
I mean, and stuff, some, I mean, for example, you found out that the universe wasn't this placid thing when you look up and is never doing anything interesting. I mean, it's a hell of a place. Right. I mean, it's crazy stuff going on everywhere. But you learned that from X-ray astronomy, from radio astronomy. You didn't learn that so much from optical astronomy. So the thing is that, and this is sort of the way Kip sort of made us all feel, and he's right. Here we're looking at it with a completely new way of what nature's shaking is doing, the mass shaking. Would you expect not to find things that you haven't thought of before? I mean, you're clearly already in the state we're already in. We have already seen things which we now see, which we knew about in a new way. In other words, we knew about black holes. We didn't know they were in pairs. We expected them to be in pairs, but nobody could tell you how many pairs there were per unit volume. That was one of the things we didn't know. And the other thing is we knew about neutron stars, and now we've seen the crash and all that. And yes, we now can see things which we didn't see before, but they're still in the context of things we knew about, but seeing them in a new way because of this new medium. So now, is there a thing which is the converse? Seeing things you don't know about and because you have a new way to look. I think there's got to be something like that. I mean, I can't prove it to you, but if it goes by analogy, I fully expect that. Now, how to look for that's another problem.
Well, my favorite place to look is in the first 1 second of the life of the universe. Yeah. Can't see that electromagnetically because the universe was too hot and dense. In electromagnetic waves, photons wouldn't propagate. Even neutrinos wouldn't propagate in that first 1 second. Gravitational waves are the only thing that does. They're our ideal tool. And the physics that was going on in there, we know pretty well back to when the universe was about a trillionth of a second. We don't know before that. It gets more and more speculative the farther back you get. And so I just want to look and see. And most likely, whatever this comes from then is a stochastic background. And so to be able to dig deep after a stochastic background that may come from the earliest moments of the universe is to me a huge goal for the future. And the third generation instruments that we talk about for the 2030s would be able to do that at a rather amazing level, a level that the amount of energy that we could detect, the energy density in the universe that you could detect is 10 to the minus 13, a tenth of a trillionth of the amount required to close the universe is the way people measure it. But okay, this is just a very impressive number. There may or may not be something at that level, but this will be the first attempt to really go after that up in our frequency band and with gravitational waves. And
it's pretty incredible being at this milestone to kind of think that we might be getting within decades of seeing that far back and to that early in the universe.
We're seeing electromagnetically pretty far back.
Right.
You know, 300,000 years after the explosion. That's just pretty damn close to the explosion.
It is.
But I mean, the example, which is a little more pedestrian that I want to tell you, is in fact, if, and this is going to happen, maybe not today, but we're going to see a supernova, there's no doubt. And that is the sort of a thing where nobody has ever seen inside one. And right, gravitational waves allow you that because they don't scatter, they just come right out.
And the theoretical simulations cannot explain what's seen.
Yeah.
And we don't know what causes the explosion to occur. There are ideas, but different models give different predictions. And people have been struggling. The theorists, the simulators, have been struggling since the early 1960s.
Yeah.
The combined observation of gravitational waves, neutrinos, and electromagnetic waves will very likely solve that problem when we see the first one or several supernovae.
It's incredible. I mean, I think even from every level of the public's understanding of science, I think it's the sort of thing that people are going to really be moved by. Thank you very much for joining me. Well, I know we're running out of time.
That's good. Okay, well, thank you for having us.
Absolutely. Thanks, Barry.